Sound is always the biggest challenge of this.
Yeah, we're lucky. We just eliminated it.
It's a brilliant device. Yeah, I've been thinking about that.
We brought a musical score in, and yeah, we'll just play some music over this interview.
You have to drag all that other gear around, so. That's how we shot all of our portraits. They're just staring, looking into the camera, and nobody says anything.
Just make them sit there long enough, they'll give you something that's interesting?
Yeah.
Some of that, actually, the way the whole film is made, you know, we set up in these countries, and we're out in the open, and you get all this attention, and it takes us so long to get the shot set up that by the time we do it, no one's interested anymore, so it actually works for us.
It's just like they're more natural because they're not thinking anymore. There's,
you know, I think it's a little bit of that. You know, you're kind of an attraction when you first get there, and by the time they're expecting something big to happen and nothing ever does, it just takes so long to get the dolly track and, you know, get the dolly track level, and you know that by the time you're ready to go, it's no one cares anymore, which actually is a good thing in most cases like that. So
you're like reality TV for beautiful things instead of ugly things.
Well.
We shot the cameras there.
We shot a whole diverse kind of material, landscapes, portraits, urban environments. But,
what inspired you guys to start down this road?
Well, we worked together, God, I don't know.
Third
years ago when we were young guys, you know, we were making films together. And
so how did that start? Where were you?
No, actually, I think our girlfriends at the time introduced us. So
yeah, we got together and made Kronos, an IMAX film, in 1985, and a 45-minute film or 40-minute film, and wanted to do a longer form, and ended up being Baraka.
So when did the Kronos thing? Your girlfriends got together in 1978?
Early 80s, I don't know.
Yeah, around there.
Yeah.
And were you just similarly situated that you guys
well,
fit?
Well, the story is that I went to a screening of Coin of Scotsy, which was a film that Ron edited and was the DP on at a film festival, FilmX. It was an LA film festival.
FilmX, that's right.
Back in those days, and I just was blown away by the film and what he did, and then we ended up meeting just by coincidence, just through friends, and he was going to build a camera to make an IMAX film, a 15x70mm IMAX film. Had this, you know, and building a time-lapse camera that did motion control that wasn't used on Coin of Scotsy, so just taking that to a next level. And
Mark's an inventor.
Got that together, and then
got his creative juices flowing as soon as he saw that camera.
then we ended up, you know, with, you know, doing Baraka a few years later, and
so
24 countries. And
before that. What made you guys? Made you interested in putting together?
Can't remember that far back.
Well, I mean, were you a cutter? Were you a?
No, I was always interested in painting and art and photography. So it just.
So Coin of Scotsy was just kind of.
Yeah, I did that.
Came into your life somehow.
Just, yeah, before I was 30, was able to.
You were open to anything. You were just let's go for it.
Well, yeah, but I was always very attracted to filmmaking and especially kind of crazy. I wouldn't say crazy, but art films and.
And you were interested in technology, or were you?
Yeah, I was interested in photography. Still photography, I think,
but
that was
but
part
Mark
of it.
But Mark and I were both also interested in art and art projects, and that was our real bond there, was that we wanted to create artistic films, and that's what led us.
On broad subject matter, on broad themes. You know, just
so Coin of Scotsy was kind of the breakthrough movie in that regard.
Well, it was the first nonverbal feature film.
And it was a hit.
Well, it had a underground following and had legs. Was around for a while.
No, people were. That was a big deal. That movie, no? Do you feel like it was?
Well, at the time, yeah. It's hard to.
You're being very modest about it.
So many years ago, you know, it's hard to remember. But
So you guys got together, you came up with this camera and figured you'd go put a show on in the barn? Or is that the
Well, you know, we IMAX films at that time, the IMAX films were located in museums, so the themes of those films had to sort of have a scientific or historical or educational kind of bent.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think that we made an art film in IMAX, which hadn't really been done before. Nonverbal film that was shot in, I think, 7 or 8 countries in Western Europe, and we went to Greece, I think. It was sort of the hook, that the kind of IMAX reason for being was that it was sort of about the history of Western civilization through architecture and these amazing, these iconic monuments. But we kind of brought a lot of other elements into it. Some of the themes that were taken further in, with Barak, and it just led to this evolution of let's make a longer film.
So was IMAX funding you, or were you guys going out and getting money somewhere else? Or?
No, that was largely funded through one of the IMAX theaters, the San Diego Hall of Science, that had a theater and.
It's a very low budget film in those days.
Mm-hmm. But again, another hit. You probably won't acknowledge that it was a hit. That was a little hit, if I'm honest. But that film played forever and ever, and screen after screen after screen, right? That
was it was around for a while. Yeah. I got these guys were just so unusual. They didn't, you know.
One of the things we have going for us with all these films is that they don't need to be translated, so we can play all around, you know, in different countries, you know, a lot easier than a lot of the other ones. And it got around.
So is this
the way the IMAX works?
Between that and this film, is this your primary gig? Are there things you're doing outside of making these movies every few years?
Yes, there are.
Okay, so the challenge of this particular film, Samsara, was to make it feature length.
Well, Baraka was feature length.
Right.
You know, you explore more. You know, it's as a form. It's something that lets you provide an experience that has a lot more depth and a lot more range. You know, to make a 90.
We were pretty fearless going out on this project. We'd done Cronus, and then we did Baraka, and now we were ready to go out and do it on a bigger, more global scale. And you know, it's not that easy making a film without a screenplay or a real story or actors. So we were okay. We knew we were going to go out and just get these dynamic 70mm images, because that is our main character.
Mm-hmm.
And so we needed images that you could really get the essence of the content out of. And so we knew that we were okay with that, and then we'd get back to the cutting, and there's where the film would be formed.
So do you have an outline? I mean, you have to get in the plane and go to these places. So did you make an outline of that place would be great, that place would be great? What is that session?
Well,
what are those scenarios?
We had a, you know, an idea of the we call it a guided meditation, this kind of work, and it was based loosely based on birth, death, and rebirth, and about really that it means about the flow, about the interconnection of things.
Mm-hmm.
And so that drove us to look at certain areas and content for the film.
So you have themes of like impermanence that are, you know, and so that those are the kind of imagery that you're researching and mm-hmm. trying to access. And a lot of this also happens when you're out on the road. You know, we had a structural component with the sand painting, the creation and destruction of the sand painting as a structural mm-hmm. element, as a bookend. But within that framework, there's a lot of ways the film could go together, and that's really determined in the editing process.
So is it mostly research before you actually get there and shoot, or have you been to these places, or is it a combination of things?
A little bit of everything, including YouTube and, you know, wherever we can find, or people and friends turning us on to things.
I mean, we've been to 58 countries over the course of these last 30 years in these films, a lot of travel. We've been to a lot of places, but research now is easier than it's ever been. You know, you have so many resources on the internet to find imagery and find potential material, and it's all set. You know, you set up, you access it before you go there. You mm-hmm. make sure you have approval. You work with local production companies in every country.
So when you start down this road, is the first challenge, how do we shoot each of these things in a way that it makes the 70mm particularly beautiful and makes the whole thing particularly beautiful? Or there's obviously huge specific choices you're making as you go through that process?
Well, working with the 70 cameras, I think a real privilege. I mean, it's not like working digitally. It's mm-hmm. you work a little slower, and you really know where you want to put that camera and where you want to put it next.
Mm-hmm.
So you can, but we were after the highest quality image we could find, because it's the content. And as I said, we were pretty fearless this time, because we knew the process, what it was like. And so that allowed us to go to locations that we had researched, but also there were a lot of a lot of content that we didn't know about that was there or other locations. So,
happen to you find things that you didn't know about, and you know the people we work with are telling, you know, making suggestions, and sometimes those pan out, sometimes they don't. But we wouldn't go to a place without a real kind of shooting list, at least something that justify bringing the crew and bringing the cameras to that particular place.
So how much time do you spend at a location generally?
It wasn't much. We were about a week at the most.
Or a couple of days at a shooting location, or maybe 3 days. And we went to Ladakh, India, where we filmed the sand painting being created for 3 days, 3.5 days. I think that was, usually it's even less. We'll shoot a factory in a day, usually, if that's that kind of a shoot.
Do you have a system by which you travel for all this equipment and stuff, or do you?
There's many systems. In other words, there's a whole world behind all that. We had great, we had a line producer, Miles Connolly, who handled a lot of that. Some of the, you have these, this is maybe not all that interesting, but you have Carnet countries where you can bring equipment in on a Carnet. Other countries you don't. You can ship. You go through customs, and it's just a mixed bag. And it's always, we've got a fair amount of equipment. The camera, we've got the dolly track, we've got a jib arm, we've got a very efficient package of equipment that allows a tremendous amount of versatility in the kind of imagery that we're shooting for. Time lapse and motion control, the camera that Ron designed for this, that pans, tilts, dollies. We have a jib arm that goes up 12 feet. But it's all compact and refined. It's just this just comes from the experience of doing all these films. You don't want to carry a thing you don't need, but you don't want to not have something you have to have. It's just right on that edge.
It took us 3.5 years to debug the new MOCO program, but I wouldn't recommend building all this equipment. There's a lot of unforeseen snags, but we were lucky.
Do people rent your equipment after you've used it for something?
Oh, it's
your designs
out
there. Spread out.
Yeah, it's been used for other things besides these projects. I mean, it's just a great portable MOCO system.
So, how long did you spend from the time you started shooting to the time you stopped shooting and went into post, or are you cutting as you go?
No, we cut. We really gather material for 3 years, let's say, about, and then we started editing. And then we, but we also knew we wanted to leave a little slot in there to do some pickup shoots. Once we kind of felt the shape of the film coming together, and we wanted, you're maybe missing a couple of specifics or, kind of subject matter, and we picked those up at the end.
So, what is the post experience like when you go in?
Well, we had we did something a little bit different when we worked on the edit. We decided not to work with sound or music, just with the image, and we cut these little blocks, subject blocks, because it's really about the flow, the interconnection of things. So we let the image really move us, guide the edit, and then we had a series of blocks, and then we arranged those blocks to form the film.
So do you? Are you guys sitting there? Is there somebody just kind of functionally cutting, or are you guys making those decisions together?
No, we're editing the film.
So are you sitting there at a final cut station?
Yeah. Yeah, we had two setups.
So do you go back and forth? It sounds like almost like screenwriting. Like, how do you pair up to do a screenplay? How do you pair up?
Well, it's
to
like
edit?
You said, you get, we have the that anchor, that sand painting sequence, kind of as a structural element and a key structural element. But then there's these 3-minute sequences or 5-minute, whatever they are, and they can move around. With nonlinear editing, it's easy to try it a million different ways, and that's what takes some time, because you're really structuring the film in that process. And as Ron said, you were doing it silent, which is challenging. It's a little severe. It took a little getting used to, but it really refined, I think, the way the edit went, and wasn't masked in any way, because music makes everything work better. And we brought the music in later. And
so was one of you standing over the other one's shoulder going, 4 more frames, that's not...
Well, we were all kind of together on that when we would put the blocks together. I mean, you can tell whether the flow is working or not. And, you know, there was that, you know, another beat here, another beat there, you know, something like that. But
so how far into the editing process do you feel like you know you have where things are beginning to go, that you've got a real direction and you're on the path, fully on the path to where you're going to get?
It took a while. You know, we'd have screenings, we'd show it to people and get their feedback. And
in silence?
Yeah, well, sometimes we had that, and we put on some scratch tracks and with some music that was already done. We used that, and we just built it slowly.
So how long's the cutting process?
A year and a half total in post. Yeah. I mean, probably a year in editing, and with a couple pickups in there.
Mm-hmm. And then after a year, you pretty much have a locked movie. And then
it's the kind of thing you can keep working on. You at some point you kind of say, okay, I think it's done, because you can keep working and working, you know, and trimming and, you know, but it, yeah, you know when it's finished.
Do you feel like any of your films are done? Or could you go
it's
back
like
and
recut
all of them?
It's like working on a painting. It really is. You know, you get it to a place where, you know, you got to stop. You either run out of images or money or something. You know, okay, we can stop now.
And are you guys just simpatico through all of this? I mean, you guys sound very easygoing sitting here. But
you know, we've worked together for 25 years. You know, you have obviously, you know, there we have our moments of disagreement occasionally, but here we are. I mean, we've done these three films together. You know, we've got a situation that works well, and yeah.
So, what is the hardest thing in something like this for you guys? What's the part that's you start to go, we're gonna do our third film, and oh boy, I'm not looking forward to that part of it.
You know, it's really what Ron said. It's going out without a really outline, a scene to scene kind of structure, and knowing you're gonna have to find that later is a little scary. But we had that experience with Baraka, so it was a little easier this time. I think we were just more comfortable. But you know, you still have that. You just have to have the confidence you're gonna just make the film work and do what you got to do to make it work and collect the imagery that you need.
And conversely, what's the most fun part? I mean, do either of you get off on a different part of doing it, or one of you like being on the set and one of you like cutting, or
no,
is it all the whole thing?
We're doing a little bit of everything. You know, we enjoy the whole process. You know, Mark's involved in it, not just in producing it, but he's a good cutter and artistically involved and shaping the film.
You know, I think it's satisfying when you know when we're traveling, and we traveled a lot. You know, we're there to get the imagery. We're not there to, you know, see the sights or to relax. I mean, we are satisfied with what goes on in the negative and what we bring back, and that's what is satisfying in this process. It's about the results, about the film.
So it's the end. It's what comes out at the end of the.
Yeah. I think so. Yeah.
5-year meat grinder.
You know, you begin to see it as the edit comes together and the flow is starting to work, and you sense it in there, and it's really
right.
It's,
and you know, I think what was really rewarding also was when we went through that and we put the film together in silence, and when the composers came in and brought what they had to offer in, and it took it to a level we couldn't have conceived. I mean, you know, it was just so wonderful to have them bring their contribution, the musical contribution, which is such an adjunct. It's just half the experience of viewing the film.
So when's the first time you took it out to a non-friendly audience and put it in front of regular people?
I don't know. A couple of screenings.
Well, maybe they were friendly, but they weren't your friends.
Oh. We had so many screenings.
Yeah. So you screen for school groups? Is it screen for senior citizens? I mean, do you bring in people who are not?
I think we started in Toronto, film festival, where you're going to be in a few days,
yes.
Right? And so we did that. We did a couple other festivals.
So was that the first time you saw it with a big audience of paying people?
We've seen it with we're not you know, one of these Hollywood films that has test audiences,
right,
and all that. We're not really trying to make the film for what we think is our audience. We're trying to make the film as good as we can make it. And that's what the drive is.
So are you nervous when you're putting it in front of people, or?
Well, of course you are. Everyone is. Yeah. I mean, you've worked on something for 5 years, and that's it. You know,
yeah.
It's like standing up there with your clothes off or something.
You know? I mean, you know, you ask yourself, you know, you've 5 years and the thing's over in an hour and a half. You know, it's like, what am I? It's, you know, you do, you hope people like it.
So how do you determine what the response is in a situation like that?
I don't know.
Can you feel it in the room? Do you feel like, when people are with you or, you know, going for the ride?
I don't think we've had that experience yet. We haven't shown it to big audiences yet. I think Toronto was just...
We had a great screening. A week ago, Ron was in Asia at the American Cinematheque screening down in Hollywood just a week ago. It was a really wonderful screening in front of a great audience that was full house. Yeah, that was a real nice.
I think the Egyptian was good too.
The Egyptian, that's what. Yeah.
So is the fulfillment of having done it coming from what it is, as opposed to response to it, or whether it does business, or whether more people see it, or, I mean, are you satisfied that you've created the work of art and now you're on to your?
Yeah, I think we're lucky we got out alive, you know, and got a great film.
he's joking, but you know, honestly, when you're traveling that much, there's a lot of things that can go wrong. Knock on wood, we've made three films. No one's really been really sick or injured from going to all these countries, and that's great, you know.
So, is the next film another step? Do you think? I mean, do you guys go, okay, what's the next challenge we can overcome in this, working with this art form?
I think any project you do next is that way. You try to go another place, push it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, who knows? It could be in 3D. I don't know.
Do you love 3D, hate 3D? Are you offended by 3D?
I think it's very interesting, especially what Jim Cameron has done with it. He's reinvented it and made it more natural, organic experience.
So he did it digitally, doesn't sound like your favorite thing.
Well, but the fact that you can see the natural world in a way that you really do see it is very interesting.
But we're a hybrid. I mean, we shot in film, but we output it in digital.
Don't really have much of a choice anymore.
Well, but it's also sadly, I think the best way to get the best result.
So
that's the combination of these technologies.
So are you against shooting in digital on principle, or?
No, it's just that 4 or 5 years ago when we started, the digital cameras really weren't ready to go on the road. Mm-hmm. There really weren't 4K, 5K cameras in those days, just 4 years ago. But now, in another year, there'll be 8K or whatever.
And that's what you're up against with digital, is it's being outmoded by something else, very quickly. So
have you played with those cameras?
Oh yeah, I work with them all the time doing commercials. But 65mm is just an amazing format. It's just the fidelity, the scope that's in this neg. It just can't be beat. And I like the workflow and your frame of reference working with it. It's totally different than digital.
Hmm. How so?
Well, digital, you're just shooting everything practically, and you know, but with 65, it's really comes from a more organic place, you could say, you know, more photographic place.
Mm-hmm. And, so there's respect for the image more.
Well, more of a traditional approach that you take to it, and you're, I wouldn't say more careful, but you're just seeing the world differently. Through the eyes of a 65 camera than you are a digital camera.
So maybe you and Paul Thomas Anderson can revive the 70mm movement.
Well, maybe.
You know, part of it, it's just the workflow, what Ron's saying, is it forces a certain formality. The cameras are heavier than a digital camera. The loads are small. You know, we got a three minutes of film on there, so you don't want to just, you got to be careful, or you know, run out, or you know, turning it on. So it forces equipment's heavier, mm-hmm. but it just runs real careful. It just but it forces you to really think about it. It's just like aiming a, you know, just you just don't start firing a machine gun. You're just you know, one arrow at a time. You know, one for the bullseye.
Well, it's interesting because the debate continues on, as I'm sure you guys are in the middle of with a lot of people. But it's interesting to have, you know, that those limitations seem to be an advantage for a lot of, for certain filmmakers. And then others see them as, you know, why would you ever limit yourself when you can
just roll. Well, for our kind of filmmaking, you know, we're not shooting a lot of footage. We're not shooting take after take of dialogue takes,
right,
or action sequences. So we're really after capturing the essence of the location. That's our main character, are these mm-hmm. images. And so we wanted the quality and the fidelity that 70 offers.
And when we put out the Baraka Blu-ray in 2008, and it was the first time we had an experience taking that negative and scanning it into the digital environment, mm-hmm. that 65 millimeter negative, went back to the original 65 negative and scanned it at 8K resolution into this digital, for this digital output for Blu-ray, and realized just that the amount of detail that was embedded into that digital file was just beyond our wildest hopes. And mm-hmm. you know, and you're getting the fidelity of that large 65 negative embedded into the digital file. And that's why this works. That's why these two technologies work so well together, and particularly for our kind of filmmaking, where we the camera is a little noisy, and doesn't really matter, because you're not shooting dialogue.
So what is the theatrical life of this film? Will you have enough screens in 70 that you can go to, or is there?
Well, it's 4K. It's a digital output. It's not a film output. We have a 35 millimeter.
So nobody needs to have a 70 millimeter setup.
No. We are able to provide what's essentially a first generation experience for everybody that sees it. Unlike with film, where the reality is the prints get scratched and dirty, and you just don't know what happens to them out in the world of theatrical distribution. And so that's another thing that's nice about the digital output. But it's really the combination of the 65 image capture in combination with the digital output that really makes a magical combination for this kind of film.
So you won't make any 70 prints?
No. Never cut the negative.
Huh.
Yeah.
Well, it seems like it would be fun to just have one. To play around with, though. I guess it would be very, very expensive fun.
It would be. It would be expensive fun. Yeah, I really think that the viewing experience, this debate, you're talking about, I don't want to sound sacrilegious about film, because we're out shooting 70 millimeter film, so I'm not going to say we're not film purists, but right. I just think you get the best result with the digital output from the scan. I think it's the best viewing experience, bottom line.
Well, it's an interesting thing to have the people, those who are feeling very strongly about film, try to describe why it is that you prefer the film. It's usually kind of almost poetic conversation. Mm-hmm. It doesn't tend to be very, very literal. It tends to be, about the feel of it and the mm-hmm. richness of it and the,
You have to have a background shooting film, I think. You have to start with it, and that's it. And a lot of young filmmakers now don't have that. Mm. So they need to go out and grab a Bolex or something and shoot some film.
The internal mysteries of
or
film.
Or just get a 65 camera and go out and try it.
So how many of them exist at this point?
Well, not very many.
I think there's three of them over at Panavision, and I know there's some that Tadeo has a few that we used a Tadeo on Baraka.
Mm-hmm. And on this one?
Panavision. Not on this one, no, we used Tadeo, and I think lenses were a lot better with Panavision. Not the same.
Yeah, we had these great, great set of lenses. That's another thing. With these new improved film stocks, mm-hmm. and then going to the digital intermediate, it was just great.
And how old are these lenses? Are they?
Well, the cameras and the lenses are, I think they come out of, I think they're coming from the 40s, but you're 50, saying the 60s.
I thought it was the Well, I know that their lenses are probably along the way. They're picking up lenses along the way and refining them.
But the camera bodies, they're just real workhorses.
So who do you want to have the experience of Samsara? Did I say it correctly?
Yeah.
We're all tired. Uh-huh. Who is this movie for everyone? Do you think of it as something that, 8 to 80 can enjoy together?
No, we hope so. Yeah.
Is that the goal? Is it just universalism?
It's not necessarily, I don't know how it would be for 8. maybe 15 or something.
I have a 2.5-year-old, and the things he watches are stunning to me sometimes. He just gets completely focused in. I imagine this movie would be one of them. I should try showing it to him.
Though, what your kids were saying. When your boys watched the opening sequence, and they saw those aerials we shot over Burma, and they said, mm-hmm. is this real? Is this CGI, or is this a real place?
Yeah.
And that was really an interesting mm-hmm. thing to have some kids say.
Well, it is strange in a world where there is nothing, you know, there's so much CG out there now, even for independent films, and, you know, they changed, we were talking to somebody who had a film that was, you know, like a 20-day shoot, and they had changed the hairstyle and the person in certain scenes by electrically, and it was like, what is, you know?
Yeah, what's real and
what
what's
is real
not.
Anymore?
Yeah.
Can anything be real? But this movie is 100% real.
It is, yeah.
Yeah.
And you guys are exhausted now.
Well, we're done.
You're done. And do you now, does it just go behind you? Are you done and you're ready to think about the next thing? Or does it linger with you for a while?
Take a break for a while, I think, and start thinking about the next one.
I still got a little work to do on it, but we're just getting it out to, you know, the world. You know, we have a oscilloscope here in the U.S. and we have U.K. and Germany. There's a few countries we still need to get the film released in, but we're almost done.
And
home stretch.
And when you jump in again, it's, you know, it's going to be 5 years, so you just kind of are used to the idea of giving up 5 years of your life to your next piece of art.
I don't know.
We're not getting any younger, so maybe we'll go sooner than later on the next one.
You do a short next time.
You know, it really takes that kind of amount of locations to build up the density and the
you need that.
It's a high bar of what rises to a level of visual interest that you want to put in the film. People have seen a lot. You know, people see everything on YouTube. There's been people are very visually sophisticated now, and it's a high bar. You're up against that. It's hard to find imagery that rises to that level.
But you think you can.
But 70 millimeter can do it.
Go 70.
Yeah.